But tonight, as we entertain the kids, it's going to be a lot of fun. And then afterwards, we're going to have a float time.
Ice cream floats. Tradition.
We do that every time after the service. So be here tonight for that. And we'll have a great time with kids. And then I hope that you have a great, we'll be here Wednesday night, by the way, for our regular time of Bible study. Wednesday night. And I think we are having a meal, if I'm not mistaken. Let's consider what we're about to see here. You know, I know happens is we have so many that will come for the performance and to kind of be entertained for the season. And we understand that, and that's fine. But we also want in our prayer as a choir, as a church, is that this will not just be a performance, but if you will allow yourself to hear the message, we actually are putting the songs up on the screens behind us so that you can follow along and you actually know exactly what the words are. Many of the songs you may know, some you won't know, but each one of them has a message for us. Whenever we consider that from the very start, when God created man, he knew there was a problem. You see, he had made man be perfect, but man chose to be imperfect. God created man sinless. Man, though, disobeyed God and became a sinner. This sin, nature, is passed on to all men because we've all sinned. And that sin will separate a person from the holy, sinless God for all eternity. So even before God created the first man, it was his decision to provide a sacrifice for that sin. That is Jesus. That according to Revelation 13:8 was the lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. The whole Old Testament is filled with the story of God's deliverance. And in its pages are found the prophecies that tell just how God would send his salvation for all men. That Savior would come as a child. I wonder if in heaven, for those thousands of years before Christ came, the anticipation of the birth of this child must have been always on the minds of those angels and those of heaven. When God finally sent Jesus to change history of all time, by Jesus coming to provide that great salvation as a child. Isaiah 7:14 said, therefore the Lord himself shall send, give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. And again in Isaiah 9:6, he says that this Savior will be come as a child. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. This morning we present to you the wonder of a Savior sent from God. It comes through a supernatural story of a child born of a woman, but fathered by God himself. It is presented in hopes that if you have never met this Savior and Redeemer, that maybe today you will consider that God so loves you that he sent his only son, that if you would believe on him, you could have eternal life and never perish. We present to you now the story, One Small Child.
Yeah. Thank you.
Mary's journey to motherhood began with a gentle voice from heavenly messenger saying, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will give birth to a son. You are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and be called the Son of the Highest." That was his explanation of how this recovered past transformed Mary's confusion and fear into faith. Her excitement was transformed into thankfulness and praise. My soul magnifies the Lord. My heart rejoices in God my Savior. From now on, all people will say that I am blessed, because the mighty one has done great things for me.
Glory, glory. have come to worship Jesus. They lay their gifts of praise before the newborn King. Let us join them. Let us bow down to the shepherds and raise our voices to the angels. Let us praise the child of Bethlehem, God's Holy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Here I am. Somebody told me that he's gone and left the stable.
Tell me when this job is.
Somebody told me that the gift was in the heaven to be glory to his name.
Somebody tell me who this job is.
To us a light.
He went to the grave, but he did not linger. He arose a victor over death. And he will live and reign forever and ever. We bless you, Lord Jesus, as King of kings and Lord of lords, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, and the end, the one who is, who was, and who is to come.
Says, and we believe,
We serve the one who will live forever.
Amen.
And when the world has lost their ever-loving minds, we will sit in peace knowing that our God is still in control.
Amen.
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 Aren't you glad we serve God?
Amen.
This Christmas, let us who are true believers, let us enjoy this time knowing that even though the world doesn't get a clue, we have an answer. And let's share it with as many people as we can. Any way we can. Maybe it's just singing a Christmas song as you go through the shopping store or the stores, the grocery store. Or maybe it's just a word as you're pumping gas to the guy next to you. Isn't it great to be the Christmas season and we can serve my Lord? We can speak his name anywhere. They haven't stopped us yet, amen? So we need to do that even more. As I've been reading through the Bible, and I'm now into the life of Paul in the book of Acts, amazes me how that one man would not be shut up. Continue just to preach a simple gospel. You read his messages, they are simple. Simple. He didn't have to have deep theological understanding to be able to share Christ. He just told them that Jesus loved them, he died for them, he rose the third day, and he could save them. That's all he did. And that man, because he did not be shut up, literally God used to change the world at that time. He and Peter and John were accused of turning the world upside down. You know what? We need to be turning the world upside down for Jesus. Amen. I am proud to be a part of. I'm proud to be a part of Christianity. I'm glad to be a part of God's family. To know that there is an answer. There's a whole. I was reading a short article yesterday. How this growing idea that all religions need to come together. We need to drop down all of our God and realize that there's more than one way. The problem with that is, my Jesus said he's the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father without him. We're a little narrow-minded. Yeah, we're a little hard-headed. But I'm going to tell you why. We have the truth. And we want to share the truth with as many people as we can. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Heavenly Father, right now, as we stand before you, we praise you. Not because you were a baby in a manger. Not even, Father, that you were a sacrifice hung on the cross. But that you are the living God. That you rule and you reign. And that you will continue to be the sovereign God of the universe, of all time, in all history. We, in our little finite minds, Father, we lose sight of the fact of who we serve. Your Almighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. God, may we, your children, live in such a way that we proclaim to the world that we serve that God. The everlasting God, the one true God. And may they, Father, seek to find you as the answer for their salvation. Our heads are bowed and eyes are closed. And just for a minute, if in some way God has touched your heart about a decision you make for him, I encourage you right now just to go before the Lord and say, Lord, I come before you. I admit that I've done some things that aren't quite right. And Lord, I've not been living for you the way I should. Lord, today, I want to plant my standard in the ground. I want people to know that I serve an eternal, loving God who's redeemed me and saved me and made me one of his children. Today, Lord, I recommit my life to be sold out for you. If you are listening or you are here, maybe you've never come to know this Lord and Savior. Oh, you recognize the nativity and the baby in the manger. You know the story about Jesus coming, but you've never met him. He's alive. And he desires more than anything else to have a relationship with you. A relationship that's personal. It's not something that you get because you become a part of a church. It's personal. It's one that you get as you come before Him humbly, admitting that you're a sinner, recognizing that your sin will send you to hell, and you need a Savior. And you call upon Him who paid the price of the ultimate sacrifice and then rose the third day to show His victory over death. He's the one that can provide you with that personal relationship that will last for all eternity. We encourage you this morning to make that decision for Jesus. How do you do that? You just pray. Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I know I don't deserve to go to heaven. But I also understand that you love me. You died for me. And on the third day you came back to life, and now you want to save me. Come into my life. Come into my heart. Wash away all of my sin. Accept me now as I accept you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name. If you pray that prayer, and you mean it with all your heart, I will hear from you. Call me. Stop by my office. Visit with me. Let somebody know you made that decision today. Father, I thank you for what we've heard. I thank you for this choir and these that have worked so hard to prepare this for us. And Lord, now we just thank you for the message of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah.
Why don't we do this? Let's thank the choir. The choir has been working on this for months, and they did a great job. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Hey, baby girl.
Look at you.
Yeah, you're on there.